All right, so for time travel to be possible, three conditions need to be satisfied. All right, so the first condition is time needs to be a continuum, which means that the past, the present, the future all need to happen at the same time. Space-time continuum needs to be curved so we can take shortcuts. Lastly, the act of time travel needs to create its own parallel universe so we can overcome these grandfather time travel paradoxes. All right, so the movie Prestige is the one you will be testing on today. How do you overcome the grandfather paradox?
60-second adventures in thought. Number 2, the grandfather paradox. Will time travel ever be possible? René Barjavel was a French journalist and science fiction writer who spent a lot of his time thinking about time travel. In 1943, Barjavel asked what would happen if a man went back in time to a date before his parents were born and killed his own grandfather. With no grandfather, one of the man's parents would never have been born, and therefore the man himself would never have existed. So there would be nobody to go back in time and kill the grandfather in the first place, or the last place, depending on how you look at it. The grandfather paradox has been a mainstay of philosophy, physics, and the entire Back to the Future trilogy. Some people have tried to defend time travel with arguments like the parallel universe resolution, in which the changes made by the time traveler create a new separate history branching off from the existing one. But the grandfather paradox prevails. Although the paradox only suggests that traveling backwards in time is impossible, it doesn't say anything about going the other way.
So, how do you overcome the grandfather paradox?
But suppose a time traveler can land in the past without the constant repetition. In that case, there are other roadblocks. The most perplexing are the inconsistencies or paradoxes that pop up when we start meddling with the past.
A famous example of the kind of inconsistency you can get with time travel is called the grandfather paradox. And this is where someone goes back to the time of, for example, their grandfather. So imagine that I go back in time with a time machine and meet my grandfather in 1937. He's just about to go on a blind date with my grandmother. They've never met before. But actually, I convince him not to go on that date. He's actually interested in the races, and so I tell him that there's an exciting race with Seabiscuit that's coming up at the Santa Anita track. And so we go off together to that race. He never meets my grandmother. So what happens to me? How is it possible that I could have been born and then been able to go back in time, meet him, and stop myself from being born? So there's an example of an inconsistency. It's a loop in time that really doesn't make sense.
But if time travel is possible, nature must have a way around the contradiction.
One thing that physicists are quite certain of is that the universe ultimately makes sense.
In all of physics, in all of science more generally, consistency, self-consistency, common sense, if you like, is something that is a fundamental principle.
Physicists have come up with at least three ways that nature might act to prevent time travel paradoxes. The first is simple. Nature prevents paradoxes by making time travel into the past impossible. In other words, it can't be done. A different alternative is the strange idea of multiple universes.
One way of dealing with travel back in time is to say that you actually enter a different parallel universe after having made the journey back in time. So you don't affect the history of the universe from which you came. In effect, anything that can happen will happen. But the way it happens is by entering a parallel universe. Pretty bizarre thought.
A third solution to the paradox problem is the notion that if time travel is possible, you just won't be able to change the past when you get there. The science behind this can be illustrated by reducing the problem to the simplest situation you can think of. For example, balls on a pool table.
Let's set up a pool table that's like a time machine. If a ball enters one pocket, it travels through a wormhole and can exit another pocket before it entered the first pocket. So it's a time machine. So now suppose the ball really does go through the first pocket, emerges before it entered, and then hits itself before it entered the first pocket. That would deflect it, preventing it from entering the first pocket, and thus preventing it from having exited the second pocket and done the deflection in the first place. So it's a paradox. However, the idea of self-consistent solutions gives us a way out of this paradox. Suppose that the ball exiting the second pocket can only hit itself in such a way as to deflect it into the first pocket. Then the whole loop is self-consistent. There's no paradox. We think that nature always somehow manages to choose the solution that provides self-consistency. In other words, you always get a solution that does not produce a paradox.
If that's the case, Clifford Johnson were able to travel to the year 1937, he might be able to meet his grandfather. But despite his best efforts, nothing he does would alter the fact that somehow his grandfather will meet his grandmother to allow Clifford to be born. One way or another, the universe will prevent him from changing history.
All right, so there are three ways you can overcome the grandfather paradox. First one is from Stephen Hawking. It's known as the time travel protection conjecture. It means that the time travel to the past cannot be done. That's it. Simple solution to overcome the grandfather paradox. Simply, you cannot time travel back to the past. It's impossible. Nature is not going to allow it. Universe is not going to allow it. It cannot be done. That solves the time travel paradox. Yes, you can do time travel, only to the future, but not to the past. Simple to the point. The second one is a little bit more compromising. Yes, you can go back to the past, says Nabokov, except you cannot alter main events. No, you cannot kill your grandfather before your father's your father. No, you cannot kill Hitler. So this is a little bit more relaxed. Yes, you can do time travel, but you cannot alter the history. This is the only history we have. You're not going to be able to change it. Why not? You're not going to be able to change it because the universe is not going to let you. You can try to kill Hitler. You're not going to succeed. In fact, there were multiple attempts on his life, multiple attempts on his life. They put a bomb in his bunker during a meeting, and just about every single person died except for him. All right, so there were multiple attempts. It's not going to happen. It's not going to work. Regardless of what you do, the history is history. You won't be able to change it. The last one is the one that we are interested in, which is the middle world's interpretation. Active time travel is going to create its own history. The average middle world's theory. For every single possibility, there's going to be a corresponding universe. All possibilities will come to pass their own universes. That's what it means. All right, so out of the three, the only one that we're interested in is the last one, because the last one is a full time travel. The way it is described in the science fiction movies, the way it's portrayed as well as described in science fiction movies. The first one is unimaginative. Stephen Hawking is playing way too safe. If the future, the past, the present all can all happen at the same time, if you can take shortcuts through wormholes, you should be able to take shortcuts to the past as well as to the present, to the future. If you can go to the future, why not go to the past? What could prevent you from that happening? That from happening, basically. Universe would. That's what it would say. Nabokov says the same thing. Yeah, you can go back to the past, but the universe is going to prevent you from changing the history. How does the universe know what you're about to do and how it's going to change it? The universe conscious, guys? What do you think? Is the universe conscious, yes or no? There's an implication here that you're dealing with a conscious universe. You go back in time, according to Nabokov, and then you find Hitler, you're about to kill him, you pull the trigger, the gun doesn't fire. Because the universe is not going to let you change the history. How does the universe know what you're about to do, and how does the universe prevent it? You cannot time travel back to the past, we'll say Stephen Hawking. It's called the time travel protection conjecture, because the universe simply does not want you to change the history. Once again, same question. How does the universe know what you're about to do, and why does it prevent it? If the universe knows what you're about to do, that implies that the universe is conscious. Is the universe conscious, yes or no?
Because past, present, and future are already determined, and they can't be changed.
Past, the present, and future are already determined and cannot be changed. I'm going to give you 5 points for that one. Past, the present, the future are already determined and cannot be changed. But within that universe, you cannot do time travel. Anyway, you can't do time travel into the past, or you cannot do time travel into the future. So that universe would not allow you to do any sort of time travel. But we know from Kip Thorne that if you can take shortcuts, you should be able to go to the past. You should be able to go to the future. None of these people say that you cannot do time travel to the future. Stephen Hawking says you cannot do time travel to the past, period. And Nabokov says if you can do time travel to the past, you cannot change the history, period. All right, so these guys are assigning consciousness to universe, awareness to universe. Is the universe conscious, yes or no? What do you guys think? I mean, there are a lot of books about how the universe says you're back, guys. Is the universe conscious? What do you think? Does the universe have your back?
Yes.
Who said the universe is conscious?
Me.
All right, April, explain.
I don't know. I just said, yeah. I just think because, like the actions in front of you that take place every time, like, the actions happen in our universe. So with every action possible that comes in our universe, like, it makes us, like, have our conscious or something. I don't know. Maybe?
I don't know. Are you talking about something like, karma?
Kind of, I guess.
All right. I'm going to give you 5 points for saying something. Are you conscious? Are you a conscious being?
Ourselves, yeah.
Yeah, how about your cat or cats or dogs or animals? Do you think they are conscious? Do you think that plant life is conscious? Plants are conscious. Are they? Do you think they are aware? Where do you suppose you get your consciousness from? Aren't you part of the universe? Can you get life from a place where there's no life? All right, you're part of the universe, guys. Life cannot happen where there's no life, in essence. So, which means that the universe must be conscious, right? You cannot get consciousness out of non-consciousness. It's out of the question. You're part of the universe, that makes the universe conscious, in essence. All right, so initially, I used to ignore the Nabokov self-consistence principle because it kind of assigns consciousness to the universe. And all of a sudden, I'm thinking, oh, wait a minute, I'm part of a universe, so you can't completely ignore this one either. In fact, in the laboratory, they've done experiments by delaying particles, this and that, making particles time travel. Nabokov self-consistency principle repeatedly works out. It's kind of weird. So there's something that governs the motion of these particles when they do time travel. Up until then, I used to ignore this. You cannot time travel back to the past. That's just too simplistic of an explanation. The one that we're interested in is the very last one. Is there any evidence for whoever's made was interpretation? If there is, then obviously time travel becomes possible. All right, so Niels Bohr is the guy who came up with the Copenhagen interpretation that we were discussing. Now, according to the Copenhagen interpretation, there is no reality until a conscious observer, by his observation, collapses these possibilities, these are known as the probability waves, into the particles that create the universe. All right, so you need to have a conscious observer who's responsible for collapsing these universal wave functions, otherwise known as probability waves, into the particles that create the universe. So the problem with his observation was what Einstein focused on, who is the observer creating the universe? It's certainly not me, it's not you. So who's responsible for the universe? So Einstein just mockingly used to say, if no one is looking at the moon, does this mean that the moon does not exist? So whose observation creates the moon if that's the case? Einstein used to ask, how about a sideways glance from a mouse? All right, so those were the problems that Einstein had. We talked about Schrodinger's cat experiment last week. Schrodinger's cat experiment was along the same lines. All right, so who is the observer creating the universe? If Schrodinger's interpretation is correct, the observer responsible for collapsing the universal wave function has to be an outside observer. When you collapse the wave function, it collapses into the particles that make up the universe. That's what it means. Has to be an outside observer. The person who creates the reality has to be a conscious being, has to be a being from outside of the universe. That's what it means. So, which requires some kind of a supernatural being responsible for the creation of the universe, which is fine if you're a religious person, but that's not a scientific view. Obviously, you cannot have a supernatural being responsible for the creation of the universe. So when you take the supernatural being out of the picture, whose observation is responsible for the collapse in the universal wave function, then you got nothing, which means that nothing is collapsing the universal wave function or these probability waves into the particles that create the universe. If that's the case, these wave functions are just collapsing on their own into every single possibility of creating these mini worlds, otherwise known as the mini worlds interpretation, which is an observer-independent universe, which means that every single possibility is going to come to pass in its own universe. For every single possibility, there's going to be a corresponding universe. That's what it means. So whoever takes the observer out of the picture.
Shoot me.
Come on.
No, we can't
shoot me.
How'd you like that?
How'd you do it?
Magic.
I'll perform this feat in a manner never before seen by yourselves or any other audience anywhere in the world.
Audience loved it.
This truly is top notch.
You need to celebrate.
A real magician tries to invent something you've got. It's something that other magicians will scratch their heads over.
I suppose you have such a trick.
That's your thing. Someone are going to remember me for.
What happened?
It was the greatest magic trick I've ever seen.
I need to know how he does it.
He has no trick. It's real.
Every great magic trick consists of three acts. The first act is called the pledge. The magician shows you something ordinary, but of course, it probably isn't. The second act is called the turn.
He's obsessed with discovering the method.
The magician makes this ordinary something do something extraordinary. Huh. Now you're looking for the secret, but you won't find it. That's why there's a third act called the prestige. It's the part where the twists and turns, their lives hang in the balance.
Julie, come on.
And you see something shocking you've never seen before. this was built by a man who can actually do what magicians pretend to do.
Real magic.
I know what you really are.
How does he do it?
You want the truth?
Nothing is impossible.
Abracadabra.
No more secrets.
Secrets of my life.
All right, so what's the promise of this movie?
The title. It's the three acts of the magician's trick in the three stages of the movie. And then it just goes on from two magicians become like rivalry, and then one's obsessed with the other's talent. So then he copies his talent, and then it just becomes like they'll do anything for, they'll do anything, any possibility in the world, just to do like the best illusion pretty much. So like,
all right, April, I'm going to give you 5 points for that one. All right, guys, what I'm asking for, the premise of the movie, most of you guys are getting better at this. I'm not looking for a summary of the movie. I'm usually looking for the premise of the movie. Premise of the movie is you got two competing magicians, right? They're trying to outdo each other using one single trick. What's the trick? It's the teleporting man trick. One guy is using his twins, right? Or twin, more like it. The other guy is using a machine created by Tesla. That's it. All right, so let's just focus on Tesla's machine. Okay, so this is the sort of stuff that I'm looking for. Just the premise, how the movie is supposed to work out, not necessarily what Tesla I'm looking for. So instead of using a science fictional character, they decided to use Nikola Tesla, an actual historic being. So why did they pick Tesla in this movie? Does anybody have an idea? All right, forget that. Who was playing Tesla in the movie? Was it Tesla himself?
Yes.
The answer to that question is no. Who was that? Who was playing Tesla? Does anybody know the name of the actor who was playing Tesla? Not a single person knows who the actor was playing Tesla. His name is David Bowie.
David Bowie?
Yeah, you got
it.
I'm just going to kill you. I was hoping that you would know. All right, so David Bowie passed away like 3-4 years ago. Amazing rock star. All right, David Bowie is the guy who was playing at Tesla. He did a really, really good job. My question is, why did they pick a real person from history to be the scientist who came up with this machine? So did he invent something like that in history, do you think? Let's focus on the Tesla machine briefly. All right, so what does the machine do for you? All right, guys. I'm going to mute everyone just briefly. If you want to say something, just unmute yourselves. All right, so here's what the machine does. So here's a question for you. What does the machine do? How does it work?
Is it just teleporting him or time? I'm not sure.
No, Jen, talk. I think you're onto something. I like it.
Well, I am watching the movie today, so I haven't watched it yet, but from watching right there, it looked like he just teleported.
All right. I'm going to give you 5 points for that one. What does the machine do, guys? What does this machine do? That's something interesting.
Yeah, go.
All right. Okay, April, I'm going to give you 5 points for saying this wrong thing. It doesn't make copies. You can't make copies like that. It's not a copier. And it's so the machine must be doing something. Where is the second person coming from? Okay, teleportation device. It kind of, just looking at it in this fashion, if those of you guys who haven't seen the movie, obviously it looks like teleportation. It's not. Something else is happening. Those of you guys who have seen the movie, immediately you go, oh, I see what's going on. What's going on there in reality?
To be able to traverse wrong, the space and
time curl back on themselves. You can start at one point, go forward in time, and come back at the point that you left.
And that's exactly what the machine does. You arrive a fraction of a second before you leave.
When the arrow of time bends around and meets its...
Now it creates two parallel cells.
It creates an endless loop in which the same events...
Except you loop once.
...over and over.
So if this is...
So that machine, whatever, the machine that Tesla came up with...
Time curling back on itself.
Allows you to be able to do time travel within this universe.
The universe just repeats itself over and over again. Every moment in time...
Except the act of time travel is going to create two parallel cells.
Just repeat an infinite number of times.
An endless loop would...
One arriving outside.
It's pretty frustrating for anyone.
So the question is Tesla, had Tesla done something like this within his own lifetime? Is that the reason why his character becomes the science fictional character in this movie that they were using? Well, supposedly he had done something like this. World War II, 1943, as they were working on the atomic bomb project, evidently there was a side project that the military was involved in, which is otherwise known as the Philadelphia experiment, according to which Tesla came up with this device in order to make these ships' radar invisible to the enemy. And when they turned on the machines, they not only noticed that the ships were radar invisible, they would literally become invisible to all the senses, eyes, you cannot see them, you cannot sense them, they would just vanish and disappear. In fact, during one experiment, one of the ships called Eldridge, when they turned on the instruments, it just vanished completely from sight. And shortly after appeared over at Norfolk, Virginia, over at the naval yard there, just briefly, and then it became invisible again and then reappeared in Philadelphia. All right, and Tesla, according to some, was responsible for this. So that's what he came up with. So the movie...
Tesla, back in the 30s, became involved with a group that was experimenting with the ability to move through the time-space continuum.
The experiment started back in Princeton University about 1939-38. And as they got the thing developed to where they could make something small invisible, then they got it to an object maybe that big. And that gathered the attention of the government.
Supposedly, Tesla was in charge of this experiment. All right, I want you to take a look at the date. It's October 28, 1943. That's when the experiment was conducted. According to Wikipedia, I think that's where I got this from. All right, so October 28, 1943.
So on August 12, 1943, the USS Eldridge, with a full crew aboard, reportedly underwent the Philadelphia experiment. On the ship, the day may have begun as any other, with the crew attending to routine duties, but the countdown had started. The Eldridge was about to become a legend.
They fired this thing up, they got the generators going. When they threw the switches, that's when all the bizarre stuff started happening.
So we turned it on, and of course, the ship became radar invisible within a short period of time. And to those who were observers on the carrier, as well as a commercial ship known as the SS Friesseth, a merchant ship, it appeared like the tests were going according to plan. But something went wrong at the last minute, and all of a sudden there was a flash of light. The ship disappeared completely and was gone for about 4 hours.
Instead of merely becoming invisible with radar or even the naked eye, legend has it the Eldridge was actually transported through space and time.
And we shot it through the time-space continuum. We arced it through.
It literally took off. I don't mean flying. I meant it just plain disappeared into hyperspace. It was there approximately 4 hours and then returned to the place where it had been originally.
Allegedly, a boarding party was dispatched to the Eldridge because something appeared terribly wrong.
There was a greenish sort of haze on deck, not very heavy, sort of like clouds in a way. The personnel were milling around. They were very sick and ill and quite insane.
And some of them had heart attacks. These were young men.
So on August 12th, 1943, the USS...
All right, so the question is, has Tesla done something like this? Is that the reason why they were using him as this mythical character? Take a look at the year, guys. October 28, 1943. When did Tesla die? Tesla died January of that year, 1943. So was he in charge of the experiment? Not really. Was he responsible for the experiment? Not a chance. Tesla was a virtual unknown at the time. All right, so he was broke. He thought that he was married to a pigeon. So he was mentally ill. And there was no way anyone was going to take him seriously. It didn't matter what kind of ideas he had. The fact that he was one of the greatest electrical engineers who ever lived mattered to no one under the circumstances. All right. And this is a bit of a hoax as far as we know. All right. So this story thought to be a hoax. It's completely made up. Something like that. Is it even possible?